The F7U Cutlass burst onto the aviation scene like a visitor from the future straight into the 1950s. Its radical design, featuring a tailless silhouette and dramatically swept wings anchored to a short, robust fuselage, defied the conventions of the time, looking more like a starship than an aircraft. This Cutlass boasted an uncommon twin-engine configuration, a rarity for fighters during this period. It was powered by twin Westinghouse J34 turbojets flanking the fuselage, which not only provided blistering thrust, but also endowed the F7U with a spacecraft-like visage. The power plants were ingeniously integrated, with air intakes boldly positioned at the forward sides of the fuselage, sharpening its aggressive angular profile. Moreover, the F7U was a trailblazer in incorporating power-boosted hydraulic controls, a groundbreaking advancement that enabled crisper handling and nimble maneuverability at soaring speeds and dizzying altitudes. It also came equipped with an ejection seat, a vital safety mechanism in the high-stakes era of jet experimentation. However, when this sci-fi-like aircraft took to the skies, it turned into a nightmare. Its ambitious tailless design caused dismal stability and control issues. Underpowered and unreliable engines, combined with severe structural deficiencies, earned the aircraft a notorious reputation as a death trap. Fatal accidents increased, including one where the pilot ejected, leaving the jet to fly out of control around San Diego for half an hour. Whispers spread about the Cutlass's problematic Nazi DNA. The question loomed large. Had the seized German research, which laid the groundwork for the F7U, been the catalyst for its catastrophic failures? Could the Cutlass be redeemed? It was a warm autumn day in 1951 at Patuxent River Naval Air Station in Maryland, and Lieutenant Commander Edward Whitey Feitner was buzzing with anticipation. He got the call from an admiral at the Naval Air Training Command, offering him a coveted spot with the Navy's premier flight demonstration team, soon to be known as the Blue Angels. He remembers the moment, quote, "It's a big deal to snag a Blue Angel slot. You're treated like royalty, crisscrossing the nation, rubbing elbows with folks from all walks, dazzling at air shows, pulling off some top-notch flying and drumming up support for Navy recruitment. There's hardly a gig that tops it." Feitner's burning question was simple, quote, "What bird are we flying?" The admiral answered what the young pilot feared the most, the F7U-1 Cutlass. As a seasoned test pilot with ample stick time in that very jet, Feitner's response was swift. He resigned right there and then. Spawned from the innovative swept-wing, tailless designs of Germany's Arado during World War II, the chance-bought F7U Cutlass was a stark departure from the conventional. She boasted no tail, her sweeping wings sprawling 496 square feet, an impressive span. Her towering nose gear, a pioneering fully steerable system, elevated the pilot 14 feet off the deck. The Cutlass also featured a number of elements new to the U.S. Navy, including fully steerable landing gear, high-pressure hydraulic flight controls, and a new jet engine design. Vought designed the Cutlass for speed, to harness the power of jet technology to the limit, and for that reason, they had decided to venture into the enigmatic technology research Germany had conducted by the final years of World War II. Based on the German conclusions, Vought decided to go with a tailless, swept-wing fighter, elements which the airplane's designers hoped would reduce drag at high speeds. Hopes were high for the twin-engine jet, with one 1948 article predicting that the F7U would prove not only to be the Navy's fastest airplane, but that it would eventually burst through the sound barrier as well. But by 1951, pilots like Feitner knew better. They had learned to fear the Cutlass and avoid it at all costs, even if it meant ruining their careers. The chance-bought F7U-1 Cutlass was a case study of an ambitious but flawed design. It suffered from chronic hydraulic leaks, erratic pressure dips, and underperforming engines, troubles that, while not uncommon in early jets, were far more severe than those of its contemporaries, such as the reliable Lockheed P-80 Shooting Star, America's first mass-produced jet fighter, which had proved its mettle as a safe and competent combat aircraft. The Cutlass's radical design, inspired by wartime German research, became its Achilles' heel. The individual who had brought German knowledge to America was Waldemar Voigt. Voigt was a former senior designer for Messerschmitt AG, the German aircraft manufacturing company responsible for many of the Nazi fighter aircraft that terrorized the skies during World War II. In the 1940s, the German aircraft industry had built up an impressive technical background in swept-wing design aircraft. At Messerschmitt AG, Voigt oversaw several experimental aircraft projects for the Luftwaffe, the German aerial warfare branch. He also developed the Messerschmitt P-1110 and P-1112 projects, involving designs for a single-seat high-altitude interceptor and a fighter powered by turbojet technology. After the war ended, Voigt moved to America to work with Vought. He supervised the development of new aircraft, inspired by his knowledge of German swept-wing designs, and by the time the Navy made an official requisition for a new swept-wing jet fighter, Vought was already working on the prototype of what would become the Cutlass. The aircraft's first flight took off on September 29, 1948, under the command of Vought's chief test pilot, J. Robert Baker, from Naval Air Station Patuxent River in Maryland, achieving speeds up to 625 miles per hour. Subsequent test flights soared beyond expectations. However, in their quest for ultimate speed, Vought's engineers had relied too much on German research, inadvertently creating a nightmare for American pilots. Lieutenant Commander Edward Whitey Feitner's decision to resign from flying the Cutlass was well-founded. Having previously tested the jet in carrier division flight trials, he harbored a deep-seated dread for the aircraft. Quote, "Beyond the factory testers, three of whom had already perished in this jet, only one other soul had flown the Cutlass before me. He'd wrestled with severe control issues, managed to land without crashing, stormed in, hurled his helmet down, and declared, 'I quit.'" By the summer of 1951, Feitner had thoroughly tested the F7U-1, concluding it was unsuitable for the Blue Angels. Quote, "We realized straight away it wasn't the answer. Still, the Navy pushed for more trials. I even landed it on a carrier 14 times before the fuselage snapped in two right behind the cockpit on touchdown." The push to feature the aircraft was heavily politicized. Feitner recognized the pressure. Quote, "There were congressmen, senators, and a few high-ranking officers pushing for their pet project to be the face of the Blue Angels." Ultimately, the team opted for the more dependable Grumman F9F Panthers, confining the troublesome F7U-1 Cutlass to solo flights by Feitner and Lieutenant Mac McKnight, who were eventually persuaded to continue the tests. Feitner seemed to be stuck testing the now infamous jet, and his loathing for it would only grow. The Navy held onto the Cutlass with unwavering determination, convinced that relentless testing would smooth out its defects and mark a monumental advancement in the quest for the ultimate 20th century fighter. On paper, the Cutlass was an unmatched aerial beast, boasting a top speed of roughly 680 miles per hour and a maximum operational altitude of about 39,900 feet. It packed a blistering punch with its 420mm cannons. It featured an avant-garde nose landing gear strut that elevated the pilot's seat 14 feet above the ground. It was equipped with tailerons for pitch and roll control, and a hydraulic system that delivered artificial feedback, allowing the pilot to sense the aerodynamic forces at play. Armed to the teeth, the Cutlass could haul two 2,000-pound bombs on its inner pylons and four AAMN-2 Sparrow air-to-air missiles alongside its quartet of 20mm cannons. When the Navy declared the winner of the request for proposals, the prototype's designation shifted from V-346 to the Vought F-7U Cutlass. On paper, this aircraft was a true powerhouse. With such impressive specs, it was expected to honor its futuristic appearance by performing like a fighter out of this world. Once tests confirmed the F-7U prototypes met all Navy standards, an order for 14 units was swiftly placed. Yet ironically, as full-scale production ramped up, so did the problems, pushing the Navy to demand more potent engines. Due to continual struggles with its power plant, the jet's second prototype was scrapped. After several adjustments, the third prototype emerged as the definitive model. Outfitted with Westinghouse J36 V8B turbojets, the Navy rolled out 288 jets to 13 squadrons. Billed as supremely adaptable in tactical operations, the Cutlass's performance initially fell flat. Its turbojet engines lacked the thrust for effective carrier operations, leading to unsafe landings and takeoffs. Moreover, the jet was prone to engine flameouts in wet conditions, raising alarms among pilots and Navy brass. Fighter Squadron 81 was the first to be equipped with the Chance Vought Cutlass. Other squadrons, including Strike Fighter Squadrons 83, 116, 124, 151, and 212 also deployed with the jet. But most of the Cutlasses were ultimately grounded due to operational challenges. Accidents mounted rapidly. The Cutlass, infamously dubbed the Widowmaker, Ensign Eliminator, and Gutless Cutlass, quickly earned a notorious reputation. High-profile mishaps included the July 7, 1950 incident when Vought test pilot Paul Thayer ejected from a flaming prototype during an air show. Similarly, on July 26, 1954, Lieutenant Floyd Nugent watched helplessly as his rocket-loaded Cutlass circled San Diego's North Island for nearly half an hour before ditching near the shore after he ejected. Lieutenant Commander Paul Harwell's experience on May 30, 1955, added to the infamy when he bailed out just after takeoff as his left engine burst into flames, spending more time parachuting from Cutlasses than flying them. One of the most harrowing episodes unfolded on December 11, 1954, during a low-altitude, high-speed demonstration at USS Forrestal's christening in Newport News, Virginia. Lieutenant J.W. Hood's F7U-3 disintegrated mid-flight due to a wing-locking malfunction, leading to his fatal crash into the water. This was followed by another disaster aboard the Hancock on July 14, 1955. Amid operations by Fighter Squadron 124, Lieutenant Commander J. Alkire's F7U Cutlass tragically failed to gain sufficient power during an approach, clipping the carrier's deck edge and erupting in flames, a disaster captured on camera, leaving an indelible image of chaos and destruction. This series of tragic incidents prompted the captain of USS Hancock to issue a stern command. All Cutlass aircraft were to be removed from his ship, a clear mandate to protect his crew from the troubled jet, despite the Navy's hesitation to officially retire these notorious death traps. Months after his abrupt resignation, Lieutenant Edward Whitey Faitner reluctantly agreed to join the Blue Angels, even if it meant piloting the notorious F7U Cutlass. During the 1953 season's inaugural show, Faitner, who had been closely involved with the F7U program, faced a critical failure. All hydraulic systems failed during a full afterburner takeoff and steep ascent. He struggled to gain enough altitude for a safe ejection, but fortunately the jet's backup system kicked in just in time. While executing the emergency landing, Faitner sliced through trees at the runway's edge, causing the left engine to ignite. Despite hydraulic fluid leaking profusely, he executed a sharp turn to align the plane with the runway, managing a spectacular, albeit fiery, landing that thrilled the onlookers. Despite these heroics, Faitner remained skeptical of the Cutlass, and the drama continued. In a notable incident, a Vought F7U Cutlass marked the first aircraft to touch down on the new runway at Chicago's O'Hare International Airport. En route to a show at Glenview Air Station, Lieutenant Hardin McKnight, piloting a Cutlass, suffered an engine flameout. Fortunately, Faitner was co-piloting and well-versed in handling the Cutlass's quirks. Directed to make an emergency landing at the newly expanded and renamed O'Hare Airport, they found the runway curiously covered in peach baskets meant to deter landings. Ignoring this makeshift barrier, Faitner and McKnight landed squarely on the baskets. Following these harrowing episodes, the Blue Angels finally judged the two Cutlass jets as unfit for demonstration purposes. The aircraft were eventually sent to the Naval Air Station in Tennessee, where they served as maintenance instructional airframes for the Naval Technical Training Center, marking the end of their turbulent service in the skies. Of all the designs that came out of the jet age, the Vought F7U Cutlass initially seemed poised to break the sound barrier with its futuristic swept-back wings and distinctive design. Despite its twin engines and advanced hydraulic system, the F7U fell short of expectations, lacking the necessary thrust and being too cumbersome to achieve supersonic speeds. At 30,000 feet, the Cutlass barely managed to reach Mach 0.98 and 0.99, even with afterburners engaged. Theoretically, it might have matched the speed of sound in a power dive, but in practical terms, this remained an unfulfilled aspiration. As the Cold War tensions escalated in the early 1950s, the demand for American aircraft to carry novel nuclear weaponry skyrocketed. New carrier-based attack planes became the forefront of this strategic shift. In 1957, Vaught undertook a comprehensive analysis of all major incidents involving the Cutlass, documenting 78 accidents over 55,000 flight hours. Remarkably, about a quarter of all F7U models were lost to these mishaps, giving the Cutlass the dubious distinction of having the highest accident rate among all Navy swept-wing fighters. This dismal safety record largely stemmed from the application of cutting-edge design principles and aerodynamics that were not adequately supported by the era's available engine technology and relying on German wartime research that, while way ahead of its time, did not have the practical testing required to guarantee a safe and reliable system. The Cutlass had all the makings of an ideal Cold War fighter: sleek, innovative, and ostensibly capable. However, its subpar carrier operation performances and frequent accidents rendered the program untenable. The Vaught F7U Cutlass was officially retired from service in March 1959, making way for its more effective successor, the F9F8 Cougar, which served the Navy for nearly two decades,